The basic idea of the loss function is to tell the error made by our model, and that's why it is also known as an error function. The basic idea of any deep learning model is that we give x and y as input. The x is used to calculate the y pred, and then we take this y pred and match it with y, which is the actual output. And by matching this, we can tell how much is the error made by our algorithm. And this matching is done by our loss function. These are two types of loss functions in the deep learning market. First, which is used for regression, and second, for classification. Regression is about predicting stock prices or temperature. It can be any real value. And in classification, we have to predict between classes like rain or no rain. It cannot have values between 0 to 1. Of course, if you attach a sigmoid or softmax activation layer, our output can be between those, and the one with more probability is the predicted class. Because of this boundary, there are different loss functions for regression and classification. Commonly used regression loss function are mean squared error and mean absolute error. And for classification, there are various type of cross-entropy loss function. First, let's discuss regression loss function mean squared error. Mean squared error is a simple yet robust loss function. Here y is the actual output, y hat is the y pred, and this n is the number of samples. And the easiest thing which anyone can figure out to calculate error is to subtract this y and y pred, and that's what we are doing. If we have two matrices like this, and if we wish to find the mean squared error, first we have to subtract and then square it. Why? Because we don't want any negative values to be outputted. Now our matrix contains negative value. If we square this, all the negative values will be turned to positive. That means in mean squared error, values can range from 0 to infinity. And now we will sum up this array, and the last thing which remains is to divide this by n, which is the number of samples. To calculate this n, we have to rewind a bit. In this array, the total number of rows is 5, and this is the value of n. If your array contains 100 rows, then the value of n will be 100. Simple as that. So let's divide this 0.44 by 5, which will be 0.088. This is a fairly good error rate. Now talking about the mean absolute error, the only thing that changes is instead of the square, there is absolute here. Let's do the same calculation as we did before. The absolute operation changes the negative value to their positives, and positives are kept unchanged. So all the negatives in this matrix will become positives, and then we will sum up this matrix, and the last thing which remains here is to divide by n, which is 5. So the mean squared error was 0.088 and MAE is 0.24. But which loss function to use from these two? It depends on whether your data contains outliers or not. In our case, these orange points are outliers, and if we make two models with mean squared error and the other with mean absolute error and fit on this data, the mean squared error has completely screwed up because it is also trying to include outliers, but the mean absolute error has ignored the outliers and just fitted on the main data. Pretty good. In short, you should use mean absolute error if your data contains outliers and mean squared error if not. Implementing this with Keras is quite simple. First, I have created a y true and y pred array, which is the same as what we saw previously. Then by using tf.keras.losses.meansquaredError, we can create an object MSE. And after that, we can pass y true and y pred to invoke that instance, and this .numpy will convert the output from tensor format to numpy. This is our output. It is the same as what we calculated before. And finding mean absolute error has the same procedure, just instead of mean squared error, we have to write mean absolute error. Coming to the classification, the most notable and frequently used classification loss functions are sparse categorical cross-entropy, categorical cross-entropy, and binary cross-entropy. They all have very similar ways of calculating the loss, but the problem is which cross-entropy to use from these three. It depends on the structure of your data, which you are giving as input. If your data is like this, where each unique integer value tells a class. Let's take a scenario where you have images of dogs, cats, and pandas, and you want to create a model which can take these images and tell which one of those is present in that image. We will give each class a unique integer value. So let 0 be a dog, 1 cat, and 2 panda. If you have this kind of data, you will use sparse categorical cross-entropy. Now, if you one-hot encode this array, this will change and you will use categorical cross-entropy. But how we can do one-hot encoding? Let's see. I have the same array as before. If we wish to one hot encode this, we will take each class from this and write it in a column wise fashion. If we only take the first row, which is a dog, so in the dog column we will write 1 and the rest class column will be 0. The second row is a cat, which means we have to write 1 in the cat column and the rest column will have 0. And we have to do this same for the rest of all the rows. The matrix you have got now is categorized. If you have this type of data, you use categorical cross-entropy. Binary cross-entropy is not much different than categorical cross-entropy. Only thing is, in categorical cross-entropy, you can have any number of the classes you want. But in binary cross-entropy, you can only have 2 classes. Therefore, the number of columns cannot go beyond 2. Now you know when to use which cross-entropy loss function, but how to calculate it. In this video, we will only cover categorical cross-entropy in depth. Categorical cross-entropy effectively tells the difference between actual output y and y' in the classification task. The formula is quite straightforward. We have to take y and multiply it with the log of y' and then sum the result and negate the entire thing. That's it. So let's do the log of y'. Then we are getting this infinity stuff all over the matrix because the log of 0 is undefined or infinity. To overcome this issue, we will add a very small impurity to our y', that is 10 raised to minus 7. And then if we calculate log of y', we will get a very nasty matrix. Now we will multiply this nasty matrix with the actual output y. We will get this matrix. Now we will sum it and then negate. And we have got this. Before coming to the final output, first we will see how we can calculate categorical cross entropy with Keras. It is similar to before. We will create an object CCE by typing tf.keras.losses.categorical-cross-entropy, and after this we can pass actual output y and y' and can see the output. The only thing is, Keras finds categorical cross entropy different than the standard formula which we discussed. After acquiring this matrix, Keras finds the mean of this matrix. Finding mean is quite simple. We will sum out each element of this matrix and divide it with the total number of elements in that matrix. And we have got the final output, which is completely similar to Keras' output. That's it. We are done with both regression and classification loss function. The main objective of the loss function is to tell the error made by our model. But we want to reduce this error, and this is the objective of the entire deep learning. So we can make better models. If you have seen first video of this series, I have told you that optimization does the job of reducing the loss function. In the next video, we will discuss optimization in depth. Until then, see my other videos, and if you are from the very future, I may have already uploaded many videos in this series. So you can get the playlist link in the description and many other useful resources. See you in the next video.